Let's call to order the New Carlisle City Council meeting for Monday, February 1st, 2016.
Mayor Mike Lowry?
Here.
Mr. McIntyre?
Here.
Mr. Reynolds?
Here.
Mr. Lindsay?
Here.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Here.
Mr. Kraybacher?
Here.
Six members present. I understand this is the first meeting ever Mr. McLaughlin's ever missed.
Ever.
At some point, if it's your pleasure to excuse him.
We will do that.
I don't think you should excuse him. I mean, why mess up the record right now?
Is that your recommendation, sir?
I don't make recommendations. That's all for you guys to handle.
All right, we'll have invocation by Councilman Ethan Reynolds.
All right, if you don't bow your heads, please. Heavenly Father, we thank you tonight for all the blessings that you've given us, Lord, and for the ability to live in this great city. Father God, continue to let us move the city in the right direction, Lord. And as in 2 Corinthians, it says, you know, where your spirit is, there is liberty. And we thank you for living in the greatest country in the world. And quite honestly, in my opinion, the best city that I've ever had the pleasure of living or visiting. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
We do the Pledge of Allegiance. Flag in the back, please. I pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Can you drop, excuse me, turn the heat down just a notch, please? Thank you, sir.
You're like sweating.
You didn't have a coat.
What are they going to do with that?
Wasn't all that hot, Mr. Doug.
Okay, action on the minutes, please, for 1/19/16.
So moved.
Second.
Mayor, before we have a motion and a second, I need to make a comment on the minutes.
Yes, sir.
It's kind of a complicated story. What you have in your packet is not the full minutes that came in your packet. It's basically my first outline. I did finish the minutes on Thursday night, and when I sent them to Randy, I ran a copy off to proof them like I normally do when I send them to Randy. For some reason, when I looked at the council packet this morning, it was the outline, and it wasn't the full minutes. So I panicked, thinking, where are my full minutes? Nowhere on my computer, so I must have deleted those minutes when I got them finished. So I got in my trash can at work, and in my trash can, which you're holding there on the table, as you go through that, it looks like I did surgery on Frankenstein, right? So what I did in a panic today at about 2:00, dug through my trash can and found my ripped-up only copy of my final minutes without the corrections on it, and took about an hour trying to piece them together. That's what's pieced. So what I would like to suggest for tonight is that the minutes be tabled until I can officially finish an official copy up, and then the 8x14 legal copy to go on the record, if that's what council wants to do. Very interesting day. I was in a real panic at 2:00, thinking, where are my minutes? I must have deleted them at some point, sent him the wrong copy, and that's what's in your, so.
Thank you for your efforts.
Well, yeah. Need to figure out a way not to delete the minutes, so I'll have a copy of that, but I will get those to you. And if we can put it on the next agenda for post sets of minutes, that would help me out.
Thank you.
Sorry about the problem, but it was interesting. It does look like Frankenstein stitched together there, doesn't it?
Little bit.
That is.
I'm waiting to see if it's done.
What?
Mr. Lindsay, go ahead, sir.
I think the second motion needs to be removed.
I will gladly react in a second.
You just want to make a motion?
I'll make a motion, Mr. Mayor. Mr. Mayor, make a motion that we suspend the minutes until next meeting.
Table.
Table the minutes.
Table the minutes. Got a motion by Mr. Lindsay?
Second.
Motion by Mr. Lindsay?
And second by Mr. Reynolds.
Till we get a proper copy.
Any further discussion on those? Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Okay. Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Kraybacher?
Yes.
Mayor Mike Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre.
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds.
Yes.
Minutes are tabled 6-0. Thank you. I'll get those to you.
Okay. Communications tonight?
None this evening.
Moving on to the city manager's report, Mr. Bridge.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of council, members of the public. Looks like we all have students in the audience. Always good to see you guys. Thanks for coming. I'd like to share with you the city manager's report. The first thing to be discussed is Twin Creeks. The last parcel that was the loaner parcel did not sell, so that is currently in the works with auditor's department. As soon as we get a copy of that deed, I will put that with the rest of them. And then I have actually scheduled an appointment with two different land appraisers. The first meeting is tomorrow at noon with Ray Gunn, and the second meeting is that same day, tomorrow at 2 p.m. with Mumma Realty. And they're just going to give us, get a quote for how much it's going to cost to get these appraised. And then once we get that quote, we'll decide out of these two, and I'm going to try to schedule a few more, which is going to give us our best bang for the buck, essentially. And then after that, we will do our honest effort to sell these parcels according to the Chapter 5722 of the Ohio Revised Code. Again, I've said it every single time I've talked about Twin Creeks. This is something that we're going to, I hate to say take our time with, but we're going to make sure it's done legally right. 5722 of the Ohio Revised Code is a pretty, it's the more you get into it, the more complicated it gets, and especially when it comes to the selling of the lots once the city acquires them. You know, it has to be done legally. So we are moving forward with it. But again, that last hurdle, getting that loaner parcel, is now in our possession, and the next step is meeting with the appraisers.
Mr. Lowry.
Randy, when they do sell, does the city, once they sell them, owe the county any tax money?
I'm going to be setting a meeting with Mr. Tom Hale to determine some more questions I have. One of those questions is that.
Because that's the one back and forth. They said we did, they said we don't. So I appreciate it. As soon as you find out, let us know. Okay?
It's complicated, and that's why I want to have the answers before I speak.
Okay.
Yep.
Thank you.
Sure.
I got one, Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Graybacher.
Do we still have a buyer, or is that... That
there was a prior agreement with a buyer. However, my understanding of that prior agreement was based off of a bulk purchase rate.
Right.
According to 5722, you have to share it, sell those at fair market value. The bulk purchase is not a fair market value point. So I don't know. Once we get once we tell him we got to do it the legal way, if he's still going to be interested or not. I have been briefly talking with his legal representation. He knows where we're at. I haven't got any word back that says he's now not interested, but again, I don't think that we'll be able to entertain his bulk price. We got to do the city's justice. You know, if we have an opportunity to sell each one of these at fair market value, we don't sell them short, you know? And plus, too, if it's not going to be compliant with 5722, we don't want to sell them, and then 6 months later, the county comes back and said, you didn't do this correctly. And my understanding with the history of it, the county's dropped the ball a few times, right. The city dropped the ball on something else, and now we're in a position we're in now. So I want to make sure nobody drops the ball.
Okay.
Mr. Lindsay?
What was that ROC code number again?
5722. It's land reutilization programs.
Thank you, sir.
Yep. If you get into it, you might want to skip out to the middle of it because we're past all the other steps.
Take a Thank good you. Nap before you start reading it.
And have a legal dictionary right now.
I like reading
well.
The ORC.
Still take a good nap before
you start. Council, any other questions?
Yep.
Mr. Bridges.
Cool. Thank you. And moving on, we got a bunch of informational items I'd like to discuss. The first one is budget work session. It is that time of year again. So I have copied the shelter house schedule. I am requesting that we schedule two tonight, two at minimum. Right now, I would like to get one scheduled for this week and one scheduled for next week. Right now, I have a tentative date as Thursday, February 4th here at the shelter house. Time can be determined and set by council.
What was it again, though?
Now, I'm shooting for the 4th of this week, which is Thursday.
Okay. These are work sessions.
These are work sessions. And then also Monday the 8th. Is that going to be enough time for us to advertise?
We don't have to advertise.
We're
just going to
one time.
Well, we don't have to advertise the work session?
It's the one time that we switched.
It doesn't have to be a special meeting because you're not going to introduce any legislation or pass anything. You're just going to have a general discussion.
I think Mr. Reynolds has an issue with it.
Yeah, I actually am booked every day this week, unfortunately, for I have different work things I have to get done, and I'll be in Columbus.
Well, sorry. We have to move forward with it. We're on a timeframe that we have to get it introduced. I mean, there's a timeframe that we have to go.
Is there a certain time you could be here by?
7:30.
We can do.
Like, I'm going to be in Columbus. I work up there, so. I mean, I trust in good faith that you guys can handle it. You know, I mean, Bill McIntyre switched roles this time. He's going. I'm not.
Do you have what's your schedule looking like the next week? Week of the 8th.
That week, I know I'm free every day but Tuesday and Friday. So.
So you're good Monday the 8th for that one.
I could. Yeah.
Could if we do it at like what time's best for council? 6:30. What's the earliest you can get down here?
6.
6:30.
6:30 is for me.
That's fine.
Six.
Even what about on Thursday the 4th even?
This Thursday?
Yeah.
I actually have this week. I'm booked every day, and I'll be in Columbus until about 8:00.
Oh, gotcha.
So like next week, I am totally free, but Tuesday and Friday.
Mr. Mayor, can we add something to that work session? Have a pool talk.
That's part of the budget work session. That'll all be included. I have a meeting scheduled with what's later on down here. So I meet with him on the 3rd, I do believe. He's going to come look at our pool and just say if he's interested or not.
Yeah, you don't know what he's
okay, saying. So we're going to have to be firm on the 4th, correct?
4th?
Thursday.
Mm-hmm.
And 6:30 was
that's fine.
Mr. Lindsay?
You said next Monday?
Monday's the 8th.
The 8th?
We're scheduling two meetings right now.
Yeah, we have to.
So that would be the second meeting?
Yes.
The 4th and the 8th is what we're talking about.
Would it be possible to do them both next week or not?
No.
That way we could possibly have all of council there.
Shelter House is booked all next week. The only open day right now is the 8th.
The 8th?
9th is booked, 10th is booked, 11th is booked, and 12th is booked. And I plan on introducing the budget on the 16th.
How do you guys feel? You want to go with the 4th?
Mr. Mayor, I move we schedule a special work session on February 4th and February 8th at 6:30 p.m.
Second.
To when it has to be what to discuss, though? To discuss the budget.
Oh, to discuss the budget.
There you go.
What day is it?
That's Monday.
Yeah.
6:30.
So that motion was by Mr. Reynolds?
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Did we have a second on that?
Mr. Lindsay. Mr.
Did.
So the motion is to conduct a work session on 2/4/16 and 2/8/16, both to start at 6:30 p.m. to discuss the 2016 budget.
Correct.
Yep.
I can put hard copies in your mailbox on Wednesday at 5:00. Ms. Harris has got some cleaning up to do because we all three met today for about 4 or 5 hours. We'll clean it up. Ethan, I can email you a copy.
That
way you can look it over Wednesday night. If you have any questions that you want to get asked and answered, you can email them to me.
All right.
That way, even if you're not here, your voice will still be heard.
Sounds good to
me. And that way we can address it that way.
You said those will be in the mailbox Wednesday?
Wednesday after 5:00.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Lindsay.
Mr. Bridge, will you be emailing those to everybody?
The budgets?
Yes.
I don't know if I'm going to email them or probably hard copy. So that you would have to come to the city building Wednesday and pick it up.
You can call for the vote, sir.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Krabacher?
Yes.
Mayor Mike Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Passes 6-0.
Thank you, sir.
All right. You booked for Thursday and Monday.
Mr. Bridge, you can continue.
Yeah, thank you. And moving on, Dayton Pool Management, I just mentioned earlier, it's actually Wednesday, February 3rd at 1 p.m. I'll meet with him. We're going to meet at the city building initially. He physically wants to go to the pool. He said he can tell a lot by looking at the shape of our pool. How much water it holds and actually where the lifeguard stands are screwed into the cement. You can tell a lot by that. So again, it's an information session for me at least. If it comes back and he's interested, I can see if he can stop by the 8th work session. That way Mr. Reynolds is present. If he can stop over and he can give his opinion to everyone.
Okay.
Give me one second. All right. And moving on, the Tecumseh PTO had emailed me, and they, I guess in the past, the city had donated a pool pass to them. So I would be looking to do it again this year with them. There's no reason why we should stop. And I'll let her know that is all dependent on if the pool opens or not. More than likely, we'll go ahead and issue the pass and just let her know. Obviously, if the pool doesn't open, don't auction off the pass.
Don't auction it off.
I don't know if you're getting very much money for it.
Yeah.
And moving on, we also have an email from Wittenberg. There's an internship possibility. I responded to his email. I told him I'm going to look into it. My big thing with this is I've had an internship in grad school where it was pointless. They have you go in there and file. So I want to make sure that the internship, if we do it, is actually going to be beneficial to the student. If we do it, obviously be in the planning department. They could get a lot of valuable experience on processing permits, doing the BZA and planning board notifications, sitting in on some hearings and meetings. So again, I want to make it worthwhile both for us, the organization, and therefore for the student as well. So I will keep council updated on that. Not sure if it's going to be a paid position or a credit position, but it looks like if it does happen, it would probably be a credit-based position. And moving on, a while ago with the CIP, we had put in there some $7,500 to construct a gas line to go to our cemetery so we wouldn't have to do the propane anymore. The quote came back $23,175 to do that gas line. So unfortunately, we will not be going forward with that project. The $7,500 and the CIP were just filtered back into the general, not general fund, but back into that fund. So we won't be doing that. That could go down if a business in the back wants to jump in on that as well. The car dealer,
A couple different ones.
But at this point in time, I would just assume it's probably not going to happen.
Okay. All those businesses back there are on their own propane, I'm assuming?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Propane.
Yeah. And also in here is a letter from Ms. Manjin. She no longer wishes to be clerk of council. We need to thank her for her many years of doing it. I checked the charter already. We only need one. Mr. Kiko is the backup. I'm still going to probably put out just for another one just in case something happens, Mr. Collier, Mr. Kiko at the same time, so we have somebody to do it. And that's how we've always done it in the past, is have two. So I will be putting out some ads for that as well.
Mr. Mayor, Mr. Lauer, motion to accept the Donna Mangan's resignation.
Second.
By Mr. McIntyre, second. Mr. Lauer?
Yeah, I'd like to say something. Mm-hmm. I talked to you about this earlier. I don't know how many of you know LaDonna. She has worked and served the city for probably close to 40 years. Fire department, she was, I think she was, correct me if I'm wrong, Virginia, was she not the first dispatcher they had in the firehouse?
I think so.
I think she was, and she's been around a long time and has been, served the city very well.
Is this something we could do a key to the city for?
I don't know about a key to the city, but I would like to see some kind of letter or something to her. She's a great person.
Okay.
I've known her since early 70s. Maybe we could work up a proclamation for it in the next couple of meetings or something, Randy.
Yeah.
Very deserving person.
Okay. Got it. All right.
Yes, sir. Mr. Reynolds.
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay.
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. Craybrock.
Yes.
Mr. Mayor Mike Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre.
Yes.
Passes 6-0.
Mr. Bridge.
And moving on, we got this nice little pamphlet in here about active shooter training for seniors, specifically geared for senior citizens. This will be held, it's actually Thursday, February 4th at 1 p.m. Looks like it is at United Senior Service Center on Pitzer Center, something on Fountain Avenue in Springfield. So forgive me for not reading that right. But it is presented by Deputy Scott Cautice of the Scott Clark County Sheriff's Office. Topics would include introduction and definition of an active shooter, and also how you, I guess, run, hide, and fight, and barricading, and fighting back, and evacuation, and so end it with questions. So if you are a senior and you do want some information, it does look like it's free for everyone to attend. Sorry for the short notice, but I heard we just got the PDF flyer actually in the mail last week. And moving on, veterans. Veterans will be doing what they call a inside meter ETR survey within the city. So it looks like they will be knocking on doors, and it looks like they may have to get inside your house. Inspections will only last about 5 minutes. So if you have somebody from veteran knock on your door, you can inspect your household too. It is a legit thing. If you have any questions, feel free to call the city building for any kind of further explanation.
Do you know, like, about what time this will happen? Maybe we can put notice on the water bill, because I think that not everyone's going to be so friendly to someone wearing a cheap polo that says veteran, say, oh, can I come in your house? I know that many people probably say no, and especially senior citizens who might not watch YouTube.
I will find out the exact pace of that. I'm assuming it's going to run over a period of time, so I don't think we'll have an issue with putting on the water bill, but we'll definitely look into it.
All right,
even though they're with veteran, will they have a city vendor pass or whatever it's called?
That's a peddler's pass.
Peddler's pass.
Those if you're selling door to door.
Okay.
So. Yeah, so I don't think they'll have.
But they're going to have a veteran pass on. I think they have an idea.
They'll be wearing veteran identification.
They're going to have a picture on ID.
Hold on.
Mr. Lindsay?
They should be wearing the ID according to the letter.
Right.
Also, if your gas line or gas meter is outside, will they still need access to the house?
Not if it's outside. I don't believe it.
I think most of them probably are.
Dispatch, the call veteran has already started their removal of inside meters to outside, so I'm sure this is one that they may have on as a hit list.
I'm going to ask you a question. I don't know how much you know about this. How accurate are they at this testing, this leak testing? It's so funny that it just showed up in our packets, because over last week I'd seen a show on TV and they were talking about all the disasters, and they were talking about how more common natural gas explosions are becoming in these towns and older like ours. Is there leak testing?
So a veteran is out usually annually with their sniffers, not doing leak checks.
Thank you.
It blatantly says in the thing that the health consultant technician will have visual picture ID and have a veteran's own contact number for that for the customer calling for verification.
Yep. Thank you.
Yeah, no problem. And moving on, this is something kind of cool. Five Rangers Metro Park is offering police cyclist course. Sheriff Kelly had sent me this flyer. We do have a bike. It's kind of old. I don't know if we'd have to buy a new bike for this to happen. The course is $100. My only concern is this. When we're going to have four deputies, they're going to go to a normal, probably shift schedule. So I don't want our single deputy on a bike if only one person.
You have deputies here?
No, we got two.
What's your opinion on being on a bike?
I'm on what?
What if you're the only one on staff? On call?
When is it?
I'm just saying in general, like, if you're the only person on, is it the best situation for you to be on a bike opposed to in a car?
No, not if there's only one person on. I mean, I don't know if you do that as something like extra or have somebody else cover the shift.
Like an extra deputy or extra
deputy, yeah.
That thing. Okay.
Is this for like a whole shift or is this just a special occasion?
I think you can probably go either way. Like if we had two deputies on one shift, then one could be on a bike and then
yeah.
One could be on a car.
I mean, just that way in case something precedent happened that somebody needed to get there quick, that deputy
sure.
Could still, you know, get on scene in a orderly fashion until
sure.
The other person can arrive. But yeah, I mean, I wouldn't see why not. I mean, depending on your guys' budgeting and stuff like that to allow, you know, anything overlapping.
Sure.
Okay. I think it was tried a couple times in the early 90s, maybe, if I remember right. I don't know how it went over.
When I was on council in the 90s, for one summer, they did have a bike cop, but they would not do that if they didn't have backup.
Yeah, there was
you got to have backup. It worked tremendously because they were catching kids in the park at night, you know, smoking weed, doing all kinds of stuff, and they'd sneak right up on you when you know they were coming.
Yellow light.
There was two on duty, one in car.
Yeah,
one
when they did that.
No, I had it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It rode up on me a few times when I was out walking, and he
basically, this one time, it's information for everybody here. Once we get more of the details down, then I'll bring it back to council.
Thank you.
Yep, no problem. And moving on.
This is one of the, what are we doing?
Well,
who's Finnegan?
Finnegan the Leprechaun. It's actually a program that's putting on by National Trail and Parks. So, starting February 23rd, there'll be Finnegan the Leprechaun at various places around town. And there's a set of four clues that's going to be given out each week. And I have already seen the clues, and two of them are kind of hard. I'm not releasing the clues early because I don't want people to get a head start. There are four locations, and each week he will be moved to a different location. So I guess you go find Finnegan the Leprechaun, you get your picture taken with him, you send the photo to National Trails, and then you get put into a drawing to win a prize. I don't even know what that is. But the prize is good. Prize is going to be given out for the week of March 21st. Again, informational. I think it's a good idea. Anytime that National Trail Parks does stuff for us here, the response is usually pretty well. I don't know if anybody came to the movie night they had here at Smith Park over the summer. It was very well attended. They're bringing that back, actually. I just got word of that, so I'll have the dates here in the next council meeting or so. But again, starting February 23rd, look out for Finnegan the Leprechaun. How are they going to get these clues out to the mass public? I don't know. I don't know how they're going to get it out. But again, I've seen the four. And yeah, so just look for Finnegan the Leprechaun.
How big is Finnegan the Leprechaun?
I don't know.
Average size person or something little or?
He's going to be physical.
Okay.
I've seen, like I said, I know where he'll be, and it's somewhere that he's going to have to be in these cameras.
He must be a big leprechaun.
About your height?
It's going to be this big, so you have to really, really, really look for him. I think it's cool. I'm excited for it. At first, he told me about it. I'm thinking, well, I'm going to get a leprechaun. But then I read about it. Saw what they're going to do.
Selfie.
Hey, think of yourself when you're a little kid going around trying to find Finnegan. And that's what it's about.
Right. You know?
All right, I think that's all. Mr. Kitko would like to give an update.
All right, Mr. Kitko.
Thank you, Mr. Bridge. Good evening, Mayor and Council, members of the public. As you have seen on the news from Flint, Michigan, about the water treatment issue that they had, obviously, I think, and fellow certified operators in the area will say the same thing, that there was many issues that led to that lead poisoning that they have going on there. This just didn't happen overnight. But I wanted to let you know that we have, every year we put out a consumer confidence report that has all our lab data on it that will tell you what our contaminants or levels of stuff that's in our water. And for instance, lead, we test every 3 years. We are on the least monitoring schedule through the EPA because we have very little amounts. And with that said, what keeps us in that is we have the same water source year after year from I don't know how long ago, but at least the 30s that they've been drilling in that area. We use chemicals such as phosphates to line our pipes to make sure this doesn't happen. The other part of it too is we do not have lead mains in our system. The only thing that we have in our system is where a residential service connection, and it's really only in the old section of town, makes a connection to our main, there's lead goosenecks. There's about 11 or 12 inch piece of lead right there. So if something, there's nothing in our main to it would become corroded to send out into the system, but one is a couple residents. And as we do have service line repairs in this section, we remove those lead goosenecks. So they would probably more affect that individual house than is a citywide issue. But we definitely take all kinds of precautions and make sure that we don't have any kind of lead poisoning. So with that said, I have entertained any questions on that.
The readout you're talking about that we print out, that goes out in our bulletin that we do once a year every so often?
Yeah, when we used to have the city flyer that went out with it. Now we post it on our webpage. It's at the library. Where else can we send that to?
Are we not
The link, it was on the water bill, so now you can click the link and anybody with a computer can view it.
Yeah, the question I had was related to having on the website, which evidently it is. Where on the website is it if I'm watching this or if I'm in the audience now and I want to access it?
Right on the front homepage, there is a hyperlink that says Consumer Confidence Report. You click that, it takes you directly to the document. It doesn't take you to another website to get to the document. It's the actual file. And we also have it up.
members of council. Mr. Lundy?
Is the hyperlinks all working now on the website?
They should be. Unless you notice when it's not, which you can email. We got one fixed today that had the recycling link on it, that was busted. The EPA one busted a while ago, but we got that fixed rather quickly. As far as I know, everything's working, it just hasn't been updated due to the issues that we're having with Microsoft Express. Well, that I'm having with Microsoft, probably me, not software now. That I spoke to Mr. Jason.
Is there any timeline on when the website will be updated?
No.
What are you thinking, nothing?
No, I mean, I still got a lot of questions and answers to go before I even give it. I don't want to say a month and it turned out to be two or three. We're looking to do slight.
Like 6 or 9.
It's not going to be that long. As everybody knows, when we get the redesign, it's going to be thousands of dollars. You know, honestly, I want to look at ways to take it off my plate because it's just a complicated thing with my Microsoft Express. I'm going to reach out to a gentleman here in town to see if he can just do a quick refresher on it, maybe add some borders and stuff on the main page. I think the content and all that stuff is going to be the same. We're going to push everything onto the city council page as far as packets and all that stuff goes. But as far as a whole redesign from top to bottom, thousands of dollars. You know, we have a pretty good website for being a city of our size. It's informative. It has the stuff on there that you need. Is it very interactive? No. But again, we're a city of 6,000 with, you know, not a lot of money. So again, for that being said, I think our website is pretty good given what we have.
Any other questions for Mr. Bridge?
Thanks, sir.
Mr. Kitko? Mr. Craybacher.
How are you? I know somebody's supposed to be retiring from the wastewater next month, March, or the end of March or something.
Possibly April 1st.
Okay, Scott.
Actually, should be, but yeah.
That's Scott Craig's. But anyway, is he going to be replaced? Or?
Yes.
So you're going to hire somebody else?
The process has already been going.
Yeah, the process is going. We have a chain of events that's currently in going.
Okay. We've made an offer. It's based on founder drug. Everything came back at this point in time. We'll be reaching out for tomorrow to get stuff.
Okay, good.
And that's really to replace Jessica, our old former lab tech position.
Okay.
That hasn't been filled because we're waiting to see how the budget.
Yeah.
Yep.
Council, any other questions?
Mr. Bridge, I had a question. I probably should have brought this up when we talked about budgets and finance. Last year, some of us had discussed maybe creating or reintroducing sort of a budget committee so we could sit down with members of the public and go over the budget, talk about what each category means and get involved in the process. I think that would really help out with some of the issues we had last year. I know the school board started to do a similar thing, or announced they're going to do a similar thing. I was wondering how feasible it would be for us in the future to sort of get the ball rolling.
Sure.
To have that.
I thought we had a budget review committee already in place. I know that when I was doing the boards, there's a budget review committee on the boards. So I'll look into it, and then we'll have to get back to you on that.
Thank you.
If we do something like that, I'm assuming it's going to be legal some sort of notification out. My only concern is this. We need to get people on there to understand how budget works. I don't want it to be someone who's not experienced in the process and they hold us up opposed to taking us forward. It's not a learning curve situation. It is a you know what's going on. Those things are there to guide the budget, to make better decisions. So I just want to make sure that whoever is on that, they have a general understanding, not have specifically how governmental budget works.
Yeah, my hopes is that it would be another resource for someone to see what's in the budget and then go out to the community and continue.
Absolutely.
Like we do, but just another voice to help do that.
Sure. Sounds good.
Any other questions for council? Moving on the list here.
And before we go any further, there is an active shooter training discussion and approval on there. I got an email out to Sheriff Kelly regarding cost of that, so I haven't got that back yet. So we'll just have to table that or discuss it at a later point.
Okay. Thank you.
Sure.
All right. We're going to move on to comments from the members of the public. If anybody has any comments or questions, now would be the time. If you'd like to go up to the podium and ask your questions. Anyone?
Move on.
I sure. All right. Moving on. All right. Mr. Mayor. Resolution.
Mr. Lowry. I'd like to ask Randy a question. If
sir.
If he could do something. For the next meeting, City Council, could you please have Chief Trustee come and explain
Battalion 52?
Battalion 52.
Absolutely.
And be ready to answer some questions.
Sure.
You know, we've heard the comments about it, that it's a waste or not, and I don't know if it is or not. I don't know what it is. Mm-hmm. I mean, I basically know, but I would like to be able to ask some questions about it. I'm sure there's other people who would like to ask questions about it.
Sure. We'll okay. have, he's going to be here anyway, so I'll just let him know to have a detailed okay. report on Battalion 52. I thought he pretty much answered the questions last meeting.
Well, he answered questions to someone from in the audience.
Okay.
Okay, but I would, and I think there's some other people who'd like to ask some questions as well.
Okay.
Okay, thank
Not
you.
Not a problem. Sure.
Thank you.
Yep.
All right, moving on to resolutions for tonight. Mr. Collier.
Resolution 16-01R, introduction, public hearing, and action tonight. A resolution adopting the rules of council.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Lowry.
Motion to adopt resolution 16-01R.
Second.
And an explanation to this resolution. This is a yearly resolution that we do. Basically, there's a thing in our chart. It's called Rules of Council. If you haven't got a packet, I'd probably suggest you students take one and read over these. These are what the council can and cannot do. So basically, it's their guidelines. You know, it tells them what they can do in relation to the city manager, where their duties end and where they start. So if you don't know much about that city manager or council relationship, it's a good point. If you got to write a paper, good information here. So definitely take a copy with you. If there's no more left, just shoot me an email and I can email you a copy. You guys want my email address, just see me afterwards and we'll knock it off today. Okay?
Thanks, sir.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Collier.
Mr. Lindsay.
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. Craybaugh.
Yes.
Mayor Mike Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Passed 6-0.
Moving on whenever you're ready, sir.
Ordinance 16-01, public hearing in action tonight. An ordinance authorizing the city manager to enter into a contract with Cintas for the purpose of maintaining clean rugs at the wastewater treatment plant.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Reynolds.
Is this new? Have they always had a rug service down there?
Yeah, they have, but since the price is going up, we got to contact them.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
But if you will notice the back, that I did negotiate.
Drop
yeah.
it.
Yeah,
drop it. Thank you.
Sure. And there'll be another one soon enough for the city building, but that one's not done for, I think, for another 1 month.
Mr. Lindsay?
How often do they change your rug?
All about it this spring, because the council members are going to
question, I think, is for Mr. Kitko. In your opinion, how often do you think those rugs should be changed? Every 2 weeks satisfactory, or should it be every week?
We started the rug program once we redid the floor in there, and they don't seem to be, like, tracking mud or any kind of this stuff. When we say wastewater, they didn't go walk through the digester and then walk into the office spaces. It's not that type where it's, you're going to be deathly ill. It's more for protection, but no, we've been doing it now for about 5 years, and I haven't, we talked about it all the time, haven't been doing kind of complaints, no tracking it further into the facility.
Into the offices there?
Into the offices, the lab. The lab, we haven't had no issues, and we get inspected annually in the lab, and they haven't said anything about that either.
Okay. I think even if it's every 2 weeks, that would probably be sufficient.
Is it just a linoleum floor in the facility?
Yeah, the square linoleum throughout, and then these rugs protecting people from going through the rest.
This is approved in the budget, so the frequency, so everybody's students know, it's the city manager makes those decisions. We always inform the council of what comes to frequency, whether it's 2 or 4. That's a city manager decision. No offense, I just educated the students.
We've got a T-shirt.
Mr. Caller, you can call for the vote.
Mayor Mike Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Craven?
Yes.
Pass 6-0.
Moving on whenever you're ready, sir.
No. Ordinance 16-02, public hearing in action tonight. An ordinance authorizing the city manager to submit consent to the Ohio Department of Transportation for an overlay project located within the city of New Carlisle.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Lindsay.
I move we accept ordinance 16-02.
Second.
This is an explanation of this ordinance. This is for the city to give permission for ODOT, which is the Ohio Department of Transportation, to come in and what they call an overlay project on portions of State Route 235. And what an overlay project is, instead of ripping up that whole entire road and starting from the base to the finished product which we can drive on, they simply just shave off maybe 2 inches, Alan? Do we agree, Mr. Kitko, sorry?
It depends on
but they essentially shave off the top to put new ones on. So instead of redoing that whole road, they're just simply taking that surface, scratching it, and putting a new one.
Mr. Kitko, this is, if you don't mind elaborating on it, you said that this is even less, though, than an actual mill and fill.
It's like a micro surfacing.
Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Mayor? Also, I just want to put, this doesn't cost us anything. That 100% is ODOT.
There's no local match from the city on this project.
Any questions, Mr. McIntyre?
This is pretty complicated, a lot of legalese. If I'm just a regular citizen and this passes, what can I expect to see with the roads? What sort of changes and differences will I see or notice?
No, are you looking for the quality of road? Are you looking at downtime that it might be? Because normally this happens, the project will come in, they'll do some public notice, they'll barricade to try to do one half and maintain traffic the whole time.
I think, yeah, generally the quality. I'm going to see a better road, fewer damaged spots.
Yeah, fewer damaged spots. This will not be like the full shave and pave that they had done about 10 years ago where it looks like they're brand new.
I don't think it's going to be that thing where you're driving down an old road and see that nice smooth one and you want to hit the gas and go. I think it's going to be just a step below that.
That's what I'm asking.
That's what,
that's what I'm asking.
I figured that's where you're going.
They are shutting you
around. Yeah. When you hit the county line of a rich county.
And you go. It's like the instant smoothness. Like, oh, man, I thought my car was rough.
Thank you.
Now it's smooth.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Mr. Lindsay?
Mr. Kitko, will there be any additional fees or anything that the city would want fixed that we would have to pay for?
We are already preparing. We don't have any use for that project, but we are already preparing to do some in-house outside of that project.
Okay. That doesn't involve this ordinance?
It doesn't involve this.
Okay. Ordinance. Thank you.
Howie, on top of his question, actually, just thought of one. In front from McFadden's lot, didn't you say there was a water main shut off there that it broke, it's in the road, it's going to be fixed, or is that up on the curb?
It's up on the approach.
Okay, I couldn't remember, thank you. Mr. Cutler?
Mr. Lindsey?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Craybacher?
Yes.
Mayor Mike Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Pass 6 to 0.
Carrying on to the next ordinance, sir. Yes.
Ordinance 16-03, public hearing in action tonight, an ordinance establishing compensation rates for certain management personnel.
Mr. Mayor?
I'm sorry.
All right, we're going to let that motion, or let that ordinance die lack of motion and move on to the following.
Ordinance 16-03 dies to a lack of motion.
Does anyone want to explain this?
That's what I said, do you want to go ahead and elaborate on that?
Basically, anytime that there's an ordinance out there that it doesn't want to be voted on or heard, the council has the right to just let it die without discussion. In this particular case, if you look at the ordinance titles of 1603 and 1607, they're exactly the same thing. When I wrote 1603, and it's based off raises for certain management personnel, I actually looked at a different column and they're going to get more money than what they should have. So basically, since it was already introduced and had its first reading, it has to die by law, and then we just reintroduce the new one. So it's actually just like starting all over again. So this is going to be introduced, and all our ordinances, unless it's an emergency, they require two readings per our chart. The first reading, you introduce it. The second one, you introduce it again, but then that's when the council will take action.
Thank you, sir. Sure. Moving on, Mr. Collier.
On that very subject, ordinance 16-07, introduction tonight, public hearing in action on 2-16-16. An ordinance establishing compensation rates for certain management personnel.
Council? Thank you.
Ordinance 16-08E, introduction, public hearing, and action tonight. An ordinance providing for the issuance of not to exceed $27,500 police cruiser acquisition bonds and declaring emergency.
Mr. Mayor, Mr. Lowry, motion to adopt ordinance 16-08E.
Second.
And explanation of this ordinance. As I just stated earlier, this is an emergency ordinance. Anytime you see an E at the end of the ordinance number, it means emergency. The difference between that is it requires one reading. Now, how the vote works out with that is if it's a regular ordinance, you just need majority council's vote. When it's an emergency ordinance, you need 6 out of 7 to be in an affirmative vote. Usually when there's an emergency ordinance on, it's for the betterment of the city. There's a whole slew, you say life, prosperity. In this case, it's a financial emergency. Right now, we have the opportunity to get a good deal on a existing police cruiser, and we don't want that two reading to go too much further because we want to get that best available deal with that police cruiser. So with that being said, the explanation of this ordinance is the bank that we're going through, which is security, requires us to do bond counsel. I will note that council has already approved the purchase of the police cruiser. I do believe it passed unanimously.
Yes.
So this is just a follow-up to that, but it is an emergency due to us getting the paperwork and everything done in this order to get that quick.
Thank you.
Mr. Kicko has been really working hard on this for me. I appreciate that. Is there anything you wanted to add, Mr. Kicko?
Nope, we're flying through as fast as we can. The guy already has it on hold for us, so we're just kind of trying to get through the motion.
What kind of timeline are you looking at to get it preps with all the...
They said that the paperwork should take about a week and a half, maybe two. Once that's done, Mr. Bridger will be signing the paperwork. At that time, we can pick up the cruiser. At that time, I'll also be ordering, I'll let the company know to order the light outfit kit for it. That takes about 4 weeks to get in, and it takes them about 2 weeks to build. So we're about seven or so, 8 weeks to where it's ready to run.
About March then? Time March?
And I think it's about the same time as your
fourth. Yeah, the fourth deputy, I need to get an update with that, where he is. But I've already talked to Sheriff Kelly about this, but the timing of his training, his end of
fully outfitted at about the same time. If there is some sort of lapse where we don't have additional car, there is a car that we can rent from the sheriff's office. Or we can play and push them around the existing cars that we have, because at that point in time, we'll have shift work. And I don't see why we just can't use our own car when fourth person's working.
How do we decide which officer gets to do the stuff here now?
How it's going to work, but no, I'm not saying that. I look at it from this very strategic approach. The new cruiser will be driven by Deputy Cruz, and that's her day shift. I want it to be very visible. Deputy Allender has our used vehicle we just got from Wilco Township. Hopefully it's doing all right for you. Only by our another new police cruiser in 17, Deputy Allender will get that one as well. So right now, I want people who are out in the daytime to see that new cruiser. That's your tax dollars at work, and I want them to see that car. I think that there's probably more people in the daytime visible than at night. So that's how I mean that. If council would like me to look at changing that, I don't have a problem with it.
Any questions?
I think that's an excellent way of doing it. Also, Deputy Cruz has been here longer than the rest of them, so seniority should count for something.
Did you guys come at the same time?
Yeah.
Equal seniority?
Yeah.
Okay, something like that. Sorry.
I thought she was like a couple of weeks later or something. I mean, it's close. So I think, you know, that I agree with you, it should be visible during the daytime.
It is a visibility thing.
That we are doing what we promised over a year ago to do.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yep.
Any other questions, council? Mr. Collier.
Mr. Rick Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. Craybaugh.
Yes.
Mayor Mike Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre.
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds.
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay.
Yes.
Passed 6-0.
We need to, under other business, I say, first off, we need to make a motion if council would like to excuse Mr. Roman Watson from his first absence ever since being on council. So moved.
Exactly.
He wanted me to emphasize ever.
He told me that on the phone, too. He's like, make sure they say ever.
Ever.
Ever. That's right. Make sure you put that down. So,
twice. Bolded, underlined.
Mr. Lindsay.
So if Mr. McLaughlin was not excused, it would also be the first time ever, right?
Correct.
That's right.
If somebody's not been excused?
Pardon me?
No,
I meant for him.
For you, one of them?
Oh, yeah.
Is he one of these?
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin is excused.
Mr. Collier, before we go into the other business that you'll have you read off, Mr. Craybaugh.
Yeah. I just want, you know, we're trying to do the garden, you know, we're trying to do this new car out garden, is what we call it, behind Madison School to the left a little bit. And I got some details, okay, and I just want to pass out the details. And it comes from a grant that was written. I think Linda did a great job. I think there's a bullet here. Score there. And Linda did a great job in introducing this. It has a diagram on the back side on one of the pages. And I just want to make people inform. Okay? I just want to make people inform that that's fastly coming. You know? And we do have meetings on Tuesday. Tomorrow night we have meetings at the library at 6 o'clock for the community garden. So
thank you. Anything else?
Councilman? Mr. Craybaugh, that's tomorrow night?
That's tomorrow night at the library. We're having the meetings coincide with council meetings for Tuesday after the council meeting. At 6 o'clock.
What time is it?
6 o'clock. It's 1 hour. Let's make sure it's 6 to 7. And fast pace.
And Mr. Bridge.
Before we go on,
hold on.
what's the long-term goal of this project?
The long-term goal, basically, right now, is to try to make it even an educational park. First year, we don't know what we're going to do. Just try to just make a community garden with plants and everything. We hope that we can actually make the part of it an athletic field, you know, for the soccer. But we're going to try to put up a greenhouse, you know, in the back, so we can even show plants and have students and kids come and do the planting, as well as having a family there.
And this is food that goes back to the community, then, right?
A lot of the food's going to go right back to the food pantry or to people who just need it.
Great.
That's where it's ideal.
Mr. Lindsay?
Also, Mr. Graybacher, who's going to till that farm up?
Well, it's not going to be tilled, it's going to be raised beds.
Okay, raised beds, okay.
Yeah, thank you.
Mr. Bridge, you look like you have something to say?
I do.
Okay, hold on a minute.
He's smiling like a Cheshire.
Go ahead.
How long were you planning that? That's not something you come up that quickly.
Go ahead.
I would like to, I'm actually thoroughly excited. Deputy Allen is going to introduce her formally, but I would just let everyone know that we do have our third deputy. Deputy Nico Lyon is here with us tonight. I would just say before you get formally introduced, thank you so much for thinking of the New Carlisle. We are very excited to have you here. Anything we can do to make your tenure here easier, please let me know. Absolutely.
Well, everybody, this is Deputy Nico Lyon. She will be working the shift right now of 8 p.m. until 4 a.m. And then once the fourth deputy starts, she'll actually be 11 p.m. to 7 a.m. She'll be a third shift deputy. So just if you guys have any questions for her, or want to embarrass her, go ahead.
Not tonight.
Any questions from council? I'll just say, I know you. Go ahead, Mr. Council.
Sorry, I think I'm going to say the same thing you were getting ready to say. Welcome aboard, ma'am. Glad to have you in our ranks.
Yeah, I was just going to say welcome, and you've already got a kind of a tough step ahead of you, because the one, you know, Deputy Allender and Deputy Cruz have already set the bar pretty high. So thank them for that. We're glad to have you.
Welcome. You know, it's a tough shift that you're going to have.
Yeah,
of course.
Heard.
Yeah. If I heard from Ron there, you know, it's a tough shift. And, you know, unfortunately, that's where most of the kiddos get out, the teens get out, you know, out of windows. I know very well. I used to have a couple of those.
Anyone else on council? Any comments? Mr. Collier, your other business, please.
Under other business, the city office will be closed on Monday, February the 15th for President's Day. As a reminder, the next council meeting will be that following Tuesday, February the 16th at 7 p.m. here at the building. So if you show up on Monday night, it will be Tuesday night. The Crime Watch meeting will be Wednesday, February the 10th at 6:30 p.m. Is that correct, Carol? Very good. Here at Smith Park Shelter House. Community events, the joint government meeting will be Monday, February the 29th at 6:30 p.m. here at Smith Park Shelter House. That will be hosted by the New Carlisle City Council, and that is open to the public. Our annual town hall meeting will be Monday, March 21st here at Smith Park Shelter House. The regular council meeting that night will start at 6:30 p.m. with the town hall meeting to start approximately at 7 p.m. that night. The council meeting will be abbreviated for the town hall meeting. That's all I have.
Mr. Bridge, I just real quick wanted to thank you for, I know you normally explain a lot of the stuff that we go over, but you kind of went into a lot of detail tonight with the students here tonight, so I just want to say thank you.
No problem. Sorry.
I'm sure they appreciate the extra 20 minutes for their hour.
Right.
Yeah.
Hey, they make it 100% on their quiz because of that extra information.
I doubt they said that.
Any members of the audience, any of the students have any questions before we wrap us up?